Welcome, dear friends. Today we are going to learn about the permeation enhancers in the transdermal drug delivery system. So first let us see what is a permeation enhancer. The permeation enhancers, these are also known as sorption promoters or accelerators. These are used to increase the permeability of the stratum corneum so as to attain higher therapeutic levels of the drug in the body. So for this purpose, the penetration enhancers or permeation enhancers are used. These are the chemicals. Basically, these are the chemicals which interact with the structural components of the stratum corneum, that is the proteins or the lipids which are present there. And thus, because of the structural alterations in these proteins and lipids, there is increased rate of drug permeation through the skin. The enhancement in absorption of oil-soluble drugs is apparently due to the partial leaching of the epidermal lipids by the chemical enhancers and result in the improvement of the skin conditions for wetting and for transepidermal and transfollicular penetration. The miscibility and the solutions properties of the enhancers used, they could be responsible for the enhanced transdermal permeation of water-soluble drugs. Some enhancers, they increase the permeability by increasing the heat at that point. So some might have direct effect on the skin, like the solvents, the surfactants, urea, 2-methylpyrrolidone, etc. They directly affect the skin. The mechanism of enhancing the permeation is complex, but most of them, they work either by increasing the hydration of the stratum corneum or by disrupting the lipoprotein matrix. So based on the method, the permeation enhancers, they are either they use the active method means. Okay, so again, the active methods, they are of the following types. The first one is the thermal ablation. So in thermal ablation, there is two techniques. One is either laser or the second is radio frequency technique. The next method is electrical method. Here iontophoresis or electroporation is used. Next method is mechanical. Microneedle is used, and other methods includes the jet injector and ultrasound. The next method is the passive method. You can either optimize the formulation, or you can use chemical enhancers, or you can use eutectic systems, or prodrugs can might also be used. So first we will see the most important type of enhancer, and that is chemical enhancer. So it is one of the most widely used passive approach. Okay, and it facilitates the drug permeation across the skin by increasing the drug partitioning into the barrier domain of the stratum corneum without long-term damage to the skin. Penetration enhancers, they have several mechanisms of actions, such as increasing the fluidity of the stratum corneum lipid bilayers, or they might interact with the intercellular proteins, or they might cause disruption or extraction of the intercellular lipids, and they might also increase the drug's thermodynamic activity and increase in stratum corneum hydration. So many penetration enhancers, they are known till date, and they are used which have mixed mode of action. The common examples are alcohols, sulfoxides, azones, pyrrolidones, essential oil, terpenes and terpenoids, fatty acids, water and urea. These are the most commonly used chemical penetration enhancers. The limitation of this chemical enhancer is that they might cause skin irritation. They might have poor efficiency and safety. They do not achieve the desired skin disruption, and their ability to increase the transport across the skin is low and variable. So in order to use any chemical enhancer, it should have some ideal properties. The ideal properties include that the most important thing is the chemical enhancer, it has to be non-toxic, non-allergic and non-irritating. It should work rapidly. The activity and duration of the effect, it has to be both predictable and reproducible. It should not have pharmacological activity. It should not cause its own therapeutic effect. Then it should not work unidirectionally. That is, only the one side barrier property, it has to be disrupted. That is, the exogenous material should only come into the system, not the internal substance. It should not leave the system. Okay, so this will prevent the loss of the endogenous material from the body. So when removed from skin, the barrier property, they should be regained rapidly and fully. Okay, they should be cosmetically acceptable with an appropriate skin fill. Permeation enhancers, they act basically by three possible mechanisms. The first is the enhancers, they disrupt the stratum corneum lipid organization, making it permeable and increasing drug diffusion coefficient. The chemicals which act by this method are azones, terpenes, fatty acids, DMSO and alcohols. Then oleic acids and terpenes at high loadings pool with the lipids. They cause phase separation and form permeable pores which allow easier access to the viable epidermis for polar molecules. DMSO, ethanol and micellar solutions, they also extract the lipids, making horny layer more permeable by forming aqueous channels. So the enhancers interact with the keratin as well, that is the intracellular protein in corneocytes, to open up the dense protein structures and make them more permeable. The examples are, the chemicals which are responsible for this are ionic surfactants, decyl methyl sulfoxide and DMSO. The third route is many solvents, they enter the stratum corneum and causes its solution properties and increases or changes its solution properties by altering the chemical environment and increasing the partitioning of the second molecule or the drug or the co-enhancer or the co-solvent into the horny layer. The example of such chemicals are ethanol. It increases the penetration of the nitroglycerin and estradiol. So many chemical enhancers, they use combination of the three mechanisms. DMSO above 60% concentration, it disturbs the intercellular organization, extract the lipids, and it also interact with the keratin and facilitate lipid drug permeation. So percutaneous absorption of most of the drugs is passive diffusion process, as it is given by Fick's first law of diffusion. The Fick's law says J is equal to DKC by H, where J is the flux of the drug, D is the drug diffusion coefficient of the skin, K is the skin vehicle partition coefficient of the drug, and C is the drug concentration in the vehicle or the product, and H is the thickness of the skin. So permeation enhancers, they act on the skin to improve the drug diffusibility, solubility or both. DMSO and ozone, they can increase the diffusibility in the stratum corneum by acting as solvents to dissolve the skin lipids and to denaturate the skin proteins. Ethanol, macrocyclic ketones, lactones, they can modify the drug solubility parameters, partition coefficient from vehicle to skin, and the permeability coefficient in the skin. The active methods for skin permeation or increasing the skin permeability includes ultrasound, electrically assisted methods, which is electroporation and iontophoresis, velocity-based devices, that is powder injector, jet injector, then thermal approaches, lasers and radio frequency heating, and mechanical methodologies such as microneedles, which is also designated as MN, and tape stripping. So these approaches, they allow a broader class of the drugs to be delivered into the skin. The active methods, they involve the use of external energy to act as the driving force for drug transport across the skin or by physically disrupting the stratum corneum. So the first method we will see is ultrasound. Ultrasound is also called as sonophoresis or phonophoresis, and it can be defined as the transport of the drug across the skin by application of the ultrasound perturbation at frequencies of 20 kilohertz to 16 megahertz. Now, it has got sufficient intensity to reduce the resistance of the skin. Now, the radio frequency waves, these are in the range that these are not audible to the human ears. The use of the ultrasound, it has resulted into the effective delivery of the various different categories and classes of the drugs, regardless of their electrical characteristics, by increasing skin permeability, especially of high molecular weight water-soluble drugs. Ultrasound can increase the temperature of the skin by the absorption of the sound waves. The first ultrasound device for transdermal application was approved in 2004 by the FDA for the delivery of local dermal anesthesia, and it was manufactured by Sontra Medical under the registered trademark of Sonoprep. So this is the ultrasound device which is used. The next is electrical technique. So in electroporation, the cells, they are temporarily exposed to high intensity of the electric pulse, and it leads to formation of aqueous pores in the lipid bilayers of the stratum corneum, and it allows the diffusion of the drug across the skin. The technique was first described by Newman in 1982. So use of high voltage pulses for very short time, only for 1 to 2 seconds, it has shown a tremendous increase in the transport across the skin for different drugs of different molecular weights, which range from small to high. Like example includes fentanyl, timolol, orcasine, to high molecular weight drugs such as calcitonin, heparin, FTC, FITC, dextran, with molecular weight up to 40 kilodaltons. The main drawback is that the lack of quantitative delivery and the cell death with high fields and potential damage to the labeled drugs, okay, which are of protein origin. Okay, so the next technique here is iontophoresis. It involves the application of physiologically acceptable electrical current from 0.1 to 1 milliampere per centimeter square to derive the charged permeance into the skin through electrostatic effects and make ionic drugs pass through the skin into the body by its potential gradient. So unlike other transdermal enhancement method, it act by mainly by involving a second driving force, that is the electrical potential gradient, as companion to the concentration gradient across the skin, since the uncharged species, they can be delivered through electroosmosis. So many of the many formulations are available in the market, and these are Lidocyte, Forisor, E-Trans. These are the examples of commercially available iontophoretic delivery systems. The first approved commercial iontophoretic patch was that of Lidocyte, and it was developed to deliver the lidocaine for fast dermal anesthesia. Then many factors that affect the iontophoretic delivery systems, which includes the pH of the donor solution, electrode type, buffer concentration, current strength, and type of the current employed. So you can see here, this is the iontophoretic device with the help of these two anodes, two electrodes. Different charge, here there is positive charge, here there is negative charge. Okay, so drug is placed here and the current is applied. So because of this movement, the drug, it moves into the skin and it will reach to the systemic circulation. So the maximum time that the device can be applied is for only for 3 minutes. Why? To prevent local skin irritation or burns. The current which is acceptable at maximum range is 0.5 milliampere per centimeter square, and it should be pulsed current. It should not be a direct current. Now we'll see the velocity based devices. Velocity based devices, it is either a powder or liquid jet injection, and it employ a high velocity jet with velocities which range from 100 to 200 meter per second. And because of this high velocity, the skin is punctured and then the drug is delivered using a power source. And here the power source is nothing but a compressed gas or a spring. The concept of jet injectors for use in the drug delivery was first explored in early 1930s by Arnold Messiter. A jet injector, it is nothing but it is a needle-free device, and it is capable of delivering electronically controlled doses of medication, which result in improved consistency of the delivery and reduced pain for the patient. The liquid jet injectors, they propel the liquid from a nozzle with an orifice diameter which ranges from 50 to 360 micrometers, and it is smaller than the outer diameter of the standard hypodermic needle, which is 810 micrometers for 21 G needle. So the jet, it can deliver drug into different layers of the skin, that is intradermal, subcutaneous or intramuscular, by changing the jet velocity and the diameter of the orifice. The major advantage of using needle-free devices, it relates to the concern regarding the safe needle disposal and avoidance of accidental needle stick injuries. So this is the jet injector. So this is the cap, this is the activation lever, you have to press it. A gas is filled here, this is the gas cartridge. Then this is the sterility cap, this is the lure cap, this is orifice through which the drug will come out. Okay, the plunger and the piston, they are pushed because of the gas which is present here. Now let us see the thermal approaches. One is laser and the second one is radio frequency heating. The thermal ablation is the method which is used to deliver drugs systemically through the skin by heating the surface of the skin. Because of this, there is depletion of the stratum corneum selectively at only that site by heating only, without damaging the deeper tissues. So many methods, they could be used to cause thermal ablation, such as laser and radio frequency. So to have a high temperature to ablate the stratum corneum without damaging the underlying epidermis, the thermal exposure, it has to be for a very short period of time. So the temperature gradient across the stratum corneum, it can be high enough to keep the skin surface extremely hot, but the temperature of the viable epidermis, it does not experience significant temperature rise. Now we'll see the laser thermal ablation. Here, laser methodology, it is used in clinical therapies for the treatment of dermatological conditions such as pigmented lesions. Okay, so the main mechanism here is that it occurs selective removal of the stratum corneum without damaging the deeper tissue, and thus it enhances the delivery of lipophilic and hydrophilic drugs into the skin layers. So lasers, they ablate the stratum corneum by deposition of optical energy, which causes evaporation of water at that point and formation of micro channels in the skin. So in addition, along with this, such approach have been used to extract the interstitial fluid from subsequent measurement of glucose levels in the diabetic patients. But the degree of barrier disruption achieved is controlled by wavelength of the light, pulse length, tissue thickness, pulse energy, tissue absorption, coefficient, pulse number, duration of laser exposure and pulse repetition rate. So Barron and all in 2003, they demonstrated a pre-treatment with the laser followed by lidocaine cream. And it was found to reduce the onset of lidocaine action to 3 to 5 minutes in human volunteers. So the structural changes in the skin, they have to be assessed at high intensities of laser employed that may be needed to enhance the transport of large molecular weight therapeutics. Next is the radio frequency thermal ablation. It involves the placement of the thin needle-like electrode directly into the skin and application of high frequency alternating current, which produces microscopic pathways in the stratum corneum through which the drug will permeate. So exposure of skin cells to high frequency causes ionic vibrations within the tissue, which attempt to localize the heating of a specific area of the skin and thus ablate the skin in that region, resulting in drug transport across the skin. The next is the microneedle, MNRAs. So minimally invasive drug systems or drug delivery system, it has the potential to be used as an alternative to hypodermic and subcutaneous needle technologies, as this combines the ease of use of a transdermal patch with effectiveness of delivery achieved using conventional hypodermic needle and syringes. So MN, there are multiple microscopic projections. Typically, they are assembled on one side of the supporting base or patch, and it ranges from 25 to 2000 micrometers in height and 52 to 250 micrometers in base width and 1 to 25 micrometers in tip diameter. The needle, it should be of a suitable length, width and shape to avoid the nerve contact when it will be inserted into the skin. They are usually designed in arrays in order to improve the surface contact with the skin and facilitate penetration of the therapeutic molecules into the skin. So these are designed to create aqueous conduits across the skin, thereby enhancing flux of the molecules ranging from small hydrophilic molecules such as alendronate to macromolecules including low molecular weight heparins, insulin and vaccines. So pain-free delivery do not cause bleeding, eliminate the transdermal dosing variability of small molecules. Only minimal introduction of pathogens through MN-induced holes can be observed. It has got potential for self-administration. The potential to overcome and reduce the instances of accidental needle sticks, injuries, and the risk of transmitting infections. And there is ease of MN waste disposal. So this is a particular MN array. So this was all about the methods of permeation enhancers. Thank you for watching.